what goes up.
Oi, Marie. Oi, Marie.
Deep in the heart of Texas.
The Shadow Lord.
No,
did it? I buy Strictly American.
Time now for spinning my dad's vinyl. Here with all his skips, scratches, and pops is my dad, Frank Vaccarello.
Thanks, sweetie. And thank you for tuning in to episode 167 of Spinning My Dad's Vinyl. I think this record may go down as my favorite from the five records we are playing in the month of March to celebrate what would have been Glenn Miller's 120th birthday on March 1st. The featured trumpet player on this album has such a soft sound that really fits in with the Miller sound, yet stands out to make each song his own. His solos are delicate, yet hardly boring, as they were when he played for the Miller Band. He was a cool-toned cornetist who always sounded relaxed no matter what the setting or the tempo. So, get ready to hear some great songs made famous by the Glenn Miller Orchestra in a setting of wall-to-wall strings and brass in Volume 167, Bobby's Miller Pearls. It's Bobby Hackett on trumpet, with more than 40 of London's finest musicians performing a Glenn Miller favorite, String of Pearls, written by Jerry Gray. Glenn Miller and his orchestra recorded A String of Pearls on November 8, 1941 in New York. Bobby Hackett was a featured soloist on that recording, and that solo is very famous among jazz aficionados. Okay, why this record for this episode? Because as we continue to celebrate this month of what would have been Glenn Miller's 120th birthday on March 1st, I thought it would be interesting to introduce other musicians that were connected to him and hear what music they recorded after his death that had any connection to him. I think this album does a great job of providing both of those features. It's different to hear music Miller made famous being played with strings and a more robust brass section. Bobby Hackett, who we featured before in episode 95 of this show, and someone we will feature again, actually played with Miller in the early 1940s, so it's appropriate we are hearing from him this month. Next up, it's the song Glenn Miller opened and closed every performance with. Moonlight Serenade, a swing ballad written by Glenn Miller. It was an immediate phenomenon when released in May 1939 as an instrumental arrangement, though it had been adopted and performed as Miller's signature tune as early as 1938, even before it had been given the name Moonlight Serenade. In 1991, Miller's recording of that song was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame. Okay, let me tell you about my dad's vinyl I have chosen for this episode. Bobby Hackett, A String of Pearls and Other Great Songs Made Famous by the Glenn Miller Orchestra. It's on the Epic label, number LN24174. It's a vinyl LP album format, released in 1965. Its genre is jazz, and its style is big band. We'll hear six of the 12 songs on this album. Now, there are some great liner notes that really tell a great story, but I will skip the parts about specific songs. In the summer of 1941, a handsome young musician with a thin mustache, carrying both a cornet case and a guitar case, climbed aboard the Glenn Miller Band bus. It was, of course, Bobby Hackett. He was joining the band to succeed Modern Era's singer Bill Conway in the guitar chair of the Miller Rhythm Section. Hackett stayed with the Miller Band until Glenn broke it up in the fall of 1942. It was a wonderful treat for listeners and dancers whenever Bobby laid down his guitar, picked up his cornet, and stood up in the rhythm section to play one of his shimmering solos. And even though the arrangements used here were by another Miller alumnus, George Williams, they are not duplicates of the originals, but a remarkable flavor of the Miller style remains. There's been no attempt to recreate that high-blown reed sound of the Miller sax section, but the combination of Bobby's horn and the wall-to-wall strings and brass captures the essence of the Miller style. The recording was a happy circumstance. Bobby was in London in April of 1965, appearing with Tony Bennett at the Palladium. Williams was available for the arranging chores, and conductor Johnny Spence was able to assume the conducting role. More than 40 of London's finest musicians were summoned for the recording sessions at quaint old Olympia Sound Studios. Bobby Hackett has always been among the most tasteful of musicians, jazz or non-jazz. This album is a lovely demonstration of his taste as a soloist and is, in turn, a tribute to the taste of Glenn Miller. It was Miller, after all, who hired Bobby to play rhythm guitar until those moments when a sound of extraordinary beauty was needed. That's when Bobby stood up, like right here. Okay, let's see what prices this record is being sold at on Discogs.com. It was sold only twice, with the last time being November 22nd, 2021. Both times it sold for $4.99, which makes that the magic number all the way around. I saw several copies for sale on eBay from $3.50 to $12, and there were a couple on Amazon in the low to upper $20 range. For the most part, my dad's record is in really good condition. However, there are a couple of skips that seem to come from nowhere in a couple of songs I am not playing. There's not a lot of hissing or scratchiness between tracks, and you can hear Bobby's brilliant solos loud and clear. The surface is relatively clean, but there are a couple of odd spots on it that wouldn't come off with just my regular cleaning. The cover, on the other hand, is in poor condition. Like I've said previously, we found stacks and boxes of albums all over my parents' house when we were preparing it for the estate sale. Some of those locations were not exactly the best conditions for storing vinyl LPs for a long period of time. So the drying effect caused some tears along the back and the bottom edges. He's got the green magic marker streak and the word "Posted" stamped on the back cover, but no address label on the front. So I will value my dad's record at 50 cents. Okay, the most famous version of this next song was recorded 30 years after it was written. The version you are about to hear was recorded 5 years after that. Thank you. the ever-popular Georgia on My Mind is a 1930 song written by Hoagie Carmichael and Stuart Gorrell and first recorded that same year by Carmichael at the RCA Victor's studio in New York City. However, the song has been most often associated with soul singer Ray Charles, who was a native of the U.S. state of Georgia and recorded it for his 1960 album, The Genius Hits the Road. A Glenn Miller performance of this song was captured on the record Glenn Miller 1941, live broadcast at the Steel Pier, Atlantic City, New Jersey. Okay, we hear plenty about the life of this trumpet player in episode 95 of this show, but we'll hit some of the high notes here. And this is from an online article from musician Kim Field, and I'll drop the link into this episode's liner notes as it does go more in depth. Bobby Hackett was born into a large family on January 31, 1915, in Providence, Rhode Island. By the age of 12, he was making real music on the ukulele, banjo, guitar, violin, and trumpet. He quit high school to become a working musician and played in every club and roadhouse in New England before he came of age. Hackett's trumpet heroes were Louis Armstrong and Bix Beiderbecke. From Pops, Hackett got an education in hip phrasing and a lifelong love for Dixieland. And he learned volumes about playing the changes and finding the pretty notes from Bix. But as far as the remarkable tone he achieved on the horn is concerned, well, that was all Hackett, and he had it from the start. Hackett went to New York City in 1937 and began a decades-long musical partnership with guitarist and bandleader Eddie Condon. By 1938, Hackett's reputation was such that he was recruited by Benny Goodman to recreate Beiderbecke's famous solo on I'm Coming, Virginia at Goodman's historic 1938 Carnegie Hall concert. The next year, the MCA agency asked Hackett to form a big band, but the group never took off and Hackett ended up deep in debt. Dental surgery left him temporarily unable to play his horn, and Hackett joined the Glenn Miller Band as a guitarist. The stint with Miller enabled Hackett to get back on his feet financially and to ease back into playing the trumpet again. By the way, that's Hackett doing the famous trumpet solo on the bridge of Miller's monster hit, String of Pearls. Louis Armstrong included Hackett in his 1947 Town Hall Jazz Concert, and the following year, Hackett made a splash with his brilliant playing on Frank Sinatra's recordings of I've Got a Crush on You and Body and Soul. If you go looking for the ultimate example of an instrumentalist setting up and complimenting a singer, you will definitely run into Hackett, who by now had become the undisputed king of the cadenza, brilliantly chaperoning Sinatra's baritone on Body and Soul. In 1952, comedy star and frustrated musician Jackie Gleason, inspired by seeing how lush music intensified a Clark Gable movie love scene, sold Capitol Records on the idea of an album of romantic instrumentals with a tinge of jazz. If Gable needs music, a guy in Brooklyn must be desperate, unquote. The resulting record, Music for Lovers Only, which was built around Hackett's gorgeous playing, still holds the record for the longest stay, 153 weeks, on the Billboard Top 10 charts. 10 more make-out albums under Gleason's name followed, 7 featuring Hackett. Every one of them sold at least a million copies. He brought the checks, was Hackett's comment when asked what role Gleason had played in recording the records. Hackett's solos became the soundtrack to the making of the boomer generation. Capitol eventually got wise and signed Bobby Hackett to his own contract. Hackett released several great albums for the label over the next few years, some romantic albums of his own, some fronting Dixieland groups, and others featuring his own quartet and pianist Dave McKenna. Hackett also recorded and toured with Tony Bennett between 1965 and 1967. Louis Armstrong was quick to tell everyone who would listen that he was Bobby Hackett's biggest fan. Dizzy Gillespie and Miles Davis revered him too. Hackett's playing was relentlessly tasteful and always perfectly suited to the material. He snaked through chord changes like no other, and a beautiful melody never had a better friend. Hackett was a supremely smart player who stuck to the trumpet's sweet spot, its middle register. In fact, a story goes once when he tried to sell one of his horns, he claimed, only half in jest, that the upper register was brand new because it had never been used. Bobby Hackett died June 7, 1976 of a heart attack. He was 61. Okay, next up was another number one hit for the Glenn Miller Orchestra. There was Tuxedo Junction. It was a popular big band song recorded by Glenn Miller and his orchestra, becoming a number one hit in 1940. It was written by Erskine Hawkins, Bill Johnson, and Julian Dash. Time now for this episode's interesting side note, and it has to do with how Hackett could be considered a bridge between Bix and Miles. Bobby Hackett, often revered as a virtuoso trumpeter, possesses a unique musical lineage that bridges the styles of two iconic figures in jazz history, Bix Beiderbecke and Miles Davis, all of whom played cool as opposed to the dominant hot trumpeters and had the knack for making every note count. Hackett's melodic sensibility and improvisational prowess harken back to the lyrical emotive playing of Bix Beiderbecke, the legendary jazz cornetist of the 1920s. Much like Beiderbecke, Hackett had an innate ability to infuse his solos with a sense of longing and melancholy, capturing the essence of jazz as a deeply emotional art form. Yet, Hackett's influence extends beyond the traditional jazz of Beiderbecke's era, reaching into the realms of cool jazz and beyond, echoing the innovations of Miles Davis. Like Davis, Hackett was not only a master of his instrument, but also a pioneer in exploring new harmonic territories and pushing the boundaries of jazz expression. His smooth, lyrical phrasing and understated yet profound improvisations anticipated the cool jazz movement that would later characterize Davis's iconic sound. In this way, Hackett serves as a vital link between the traditional jazz of Beiderbecke and the modern innovations of Davis, embodying the evolution of the trumpet in jazz across generations. But no matter how he was compared, he had his own distinctive sound. Okay, the liner notes mention that some of the program chosen for this record included tunes that Miller never recorded but that were in his dance book. The material chosen for this date, with one exception, quite closely identified with Glenn Miller. The exception was this next song, which Bobby had liked for a long time and which he had a yen to record. It's performed with the wall-to-wall string and brass sound here, and see for yourself if there isn't a touch of the Miller about it. Butterfly is a popular tune. It was inspired by Giacomo Puccini's opera Madame Butterfly and contains a brief musical quote from the Act II duet Tutti e Fior in the verse. The music was written by Raymond Hubble. Well, I hope you enjoyed this episode as much as I enjoyed bringing it to you. Here's another of my dad's records where I wish I had time to play way more cuts than I am able to. I just played the full 14-minute piano and orchestra version of Rhapsody in Blue a couple of weeks ago, but Hackett does a cool job with a 5-minute version of that song on this album. You should check that out. And I was glad to get to know a little more about this great trumpet player. In fact, like I said, I think this record became my favorite of the 5 that I am playing for this Glenn Miller month. Bobby Hackett had many admirers, including Louis Armstrong, who considered him one of his favorite musicians, Jack Teagarden, Dizzy Gillespie, and Miles Davis. The latter admired Hackett's relaxed phrasing and advanced harmonic ideas on his 1938 Embraceable You recording with Eddie Condon. He never seemed to hit a wrong note or play a phrase that was not tasteful. But although Hackett was at various times compared to Bix and Louis Armstrong, he had his own distinctive sound, like we've said, from the very start. And now, one of the most popular and recognizable big band tunes of all time. In the Mood is a popular big band era jazz standard recorded by Glenn Miller. It was based on the composition Tar Paper Stomp by Wingy Minone. Miller recorded it August 1, 1939 and released it on September 15th. He would go on to record it several more times. In 1983, the Miller recording from 1939 was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame. In 2004, the recording was inducted into the Library of Congress National Recording Registry, which consists of recordings that are culturally, historically, or aesthetically significant. In 1999, National Public Radio included the 1939 Miller recording in its list of the 100 most important American musical works of the 20th century. And there you have selections from one of Glenn Miller's former musicians as we honor what would have been the conductor's 120th birthday throughout the month of March. So thanks for tuning into Volume 167, Bobby's Miller Pearls, however you did. If you want more information about this show, head over to spinningmydadsvinyl.com. I'll be back next week with all my skips, scratches, and pops for Volume 168, Miller Band Translates TJB. Until then, go with the flow, my friends.